Hi there, and welcome to the Maya Learning Channel. In the previous movie of this series, I showed you how to use Render Setup to organize multiple shots in a single file, then batch render all those shots out in a single go. In this finale, I'll put together some finishing touches to optimize my basic render setup. That said, stay tuned to this channel for more advanced tips and tricks later on down the line. For now though, let's finish building a strong foundation. So far, we've set up what are essentially two different types of layers. These first four are what I like to call utility type layers, which control things like matting, primary visibility, and number of subdivisions. The other four are shot specific layers for batch rendering different cameras with the same light. Although we did name these layers appropriately, it can still be difficult to tell them apart. To make it easier, I can assign colors for organization by right-clicking. So, for example, I could color all the shot-based layers the same to make them stand out. Or I could color each shot differently if they're what I care most about. Similarly, I can color specific overrides to differentiate them if I want. This makes the setup much more readable. Speaking of utility overrides, another handy thing to override are shaders. This is useful if you have variations on an object's material, whether it be completely different looks for the same object, or the same look with different levels of detail for close-ups versus far shots. For example, for my streets here, suppose I had a shot variation where they need to be wet after a rainstorm. I could have either alternate textures or even shaders ready to go, but how do I apply them without messing up my previous shots? For this example, I'll be using this new aerial shot labeled 31. Now I want to override the texture used by the street. However, I don't want to override the entire shading group since it has things like displacement mapping plugged into it. So instead, I'll just override the surface shader. I'll start by creating a new collection, which I'll call Street Shader Switch. Then I'll add the street as a static entry. Next, I'll right-click and add a shader override. Now I have a new collection containing all the street's connected shading groups, as well as a shader override. I'll just rename this Wet Toggle. Now I'll override with a brand new AI standard surface shader. Then assign a texture. And finally grab the wet version of my main intersection file. And now if I render, at first, this seems to have done the job since my shader has been replaced. However, zoom out and you'll see a problem. The same texture appears on all the streets. This is because the override has been applied directly below my wet toggle collection, which as I showed earlier contains all the street's shaders. So to fix that, I'll create a sub-collection called main intersect. Then add just one specific shading group to it. So that's main intersect SG. Then I'll middle drag the override here instead, so that it only applies to the main intersection shading group. And if I re-render, the intersection is now the only thing wet. This is pretty awesome now because I can swap between my wet and dry variants just by enabling or disabling this collection. See? Not only that, but I can even make additional changes to my wet shader too. For example, I can increase the metalness to get a shinier surface. Also add the original specular color file back in. Then I'll just rename the shader AI main intersect wet. That's one down. Now I can just repeat the process for my other shading groups. So I'll create a collection called Main Streets, add the Main Streets shading group, override the shader, and again reference a new color file. Then rename it AI Main Streets Wet. And so on for the other two shading groups. As you can see from the render, all my roads now look appropriately wet, and I can switch them all back to the dry look at the press of a button. If you wanted to take this even further, you could add wet looks for the buildings and cars, or perhaps combine it with some transform overrides to do a before and after earthquake scene by subbing in cracked road textures and flipping some cars over. Or you could override the same texture at different qualities to do shot-specific LODs. Really, the sky's the limit. So our setup here is almost done. We have all the functionality we want. All that's left is to optimize it a bit. To that end, I can use overrides to prune my shots by disabling objects that are too far away to have any effect. This is especially useful in a close-up like shot 27, where many of the buildings are not only behind the camera, but too far away to contribute to any reflections or refractions. So I'll create a collection for them called Prune, then start adding really distant objects. Now if I disable this collection, the objects disappear from my scene. Note that this is different from the primary visibility I override earlier in the series, which removed an object from the scene but still kept it for reflections and refractions. Turning off objects in a layer removes them completely from the render, speeding it up considerably. Just be careful not to remove anything that casts reflections, refractions, or shadows into the shot, like this building here, otherwise it won't be accurate anymore. Then I can repeat this process for each shot, pruning out different objects from each one. So now each of our check passes are pruned and ready to go. The last step before sending these off down the pipeline is to combine my utility and shot layers together. Typically, different artists downstream will be in charge of finishing each of these child shots, so I want to pass each of them everything they need for finishing, but only what they need. That way, they can focus on their job rendering and comping these layers together with external effects or footage. To start, I'll make copies of all my utility layers. Then I'll start in order with sequence 1, shot 2. From here, I want to take my light and my pruned objects. I could also take the cameras, but chances are my lighter already has them. That might even be where I got these in the first place. Still, I'll grab them just in case. Then I'll just copy and paste it into my first utility layer. Now I have the correct lighting and camera angle, and objects will be cut out for compositing. Now I'll paste those same collections into my other utility layers too, to add the same functionality. And then rename each of them with sequence 1, shot 2. And color them red. Then I can delete the old check pass since it's redundant. Now I can render any pass for this specific shot. But naturally, I'll want to repeat this for the other shots as well. So again, I'll copy and paste my original layers, select shot 10's cameras, light, and prune collections, and then paste those into each of the copies. Then I'll rename. And recolor them before deleting the associated check pass. Shot 24 is more of the same, except remember that we made overrides to push the robot down and the vehicle forward so that they don't block the camera. I need to make sure to copy these as well. Then I'll just continue on as before. Once you're done, this is what you'll end up with. One layer type of each shot, each with their combined overrides of their respective utility and check passes. Now they're ready for export. Depending on which LiDAR I'm sending this to, all I need to do is shift select the appropriate range. Go to Export Selected, and then name and export a template. I can do this for each shot, creating a template for each. That way, each LiDAR working on a child shot only receives what they need, while I keep everything else in the master. Then the only other thing left to send them are my lights. So suppose that I'm now the next person in the pipeline set to receive the template we just created. Specifically, I'm the artist in charge of sequence 1, shot 2, and all of its subshots. To get up and working, first I'll need to import the lights. Also, make sure not to mess with the object names unless there's a conflict. Then I'll just import my shot's template. And that's it. I'm ready to roll with all the same functionality and settings as my supervisor. Now I can start working on my lighting tweaks and subshot preparation. Now suppose I've been working on the shot for a few hours. I've added some additional position overrides to the bus, and set up my check passes for a few subshots too. At this point, however, my supervisor tells me he has some updates to the master shot that he'd like to pass down. Is there a way that I can get these updates without messing up my local changes? Absolutely. Notice that when importing the V2 of the template, render setup is smart enough to only overwrite layers and collections with the same names, thus preserving all my local changes. This means I can continually get updates from above without losing any of my own data, keeping both me and my supervisor happy. And of course, this can go on down the line to artists working on my subshots and their subshots and so on. And with that, you now have enough of a foundation to start using render setup in your own pipeline. Just to review, I showed you how to use this system to share and enforce specific render settings, set up render passes for specific objects while matting or cutting out others, optimize the efficiency of a single frame and batch renders, organize shot-specific layers for lighting and camera placement, and finally, save and share parts or all of your setups to others in your pipeline. This should give you all the tools you need to speed up your pipeline with render setup, but stay tuned to the Maya Learning Channel for plenty more advanced tricks and techniques for rendering as well as other areas of Maya.